Good morning. Today we celebrate the 22nd Sunday after Pentecost. We'll follow the order of service printed in our bulletin based on setting 3 of the divine service in our hymnal. We'll turn to our opening hymn, hymn 828, We Are Called to Stand Together. Called to stand together with the saints of ages past, with the patriarchs and prophets in the faith they once held fast. Promises and hopes they treasured, now we find fulfilled at last. Those who Jesus called apostles journeyed with him side by side, heard his teaching, felt his power, saw the way he lived and died. Then the news of resurrection they delivered far and wide. Through the intervening ages, round the world the gospel spread. Faithful heralds took the message, guiding where the Spirit led. So the body grew in stature, serving Christ the living head. Now in many tongues and cultures, songs of celebration ring. Millions who confess our Savior honor him as Lord and King. And for courage, grace, and guidance, every day their prayers they bring. To each coming generation, tell the truth, persuade, explain. Till the time when time is ended, till the Savior comes again. Till the saints are all united. I invite you to stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father, to me, Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to the place where it sets. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Glory be to God on high. We praise you, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord. Thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, the helper of all who call on you, have mercy on us and give us eyes of faith to see your Son, that we may follow him on the way that leads to eternal life. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated.
This morning are for the 22nd Sunday after Pentecost. The Old Testament reading comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31. And in previous chapters, Jeremiah lashes out against the sins of his countrymen. But beginning in chapter 30, he begins to announce the restoration of Israel. In this particular passage, chapter 31, Jeremiah records the words of the Lord with regard to this restoration. So chapter 31, verses 7 through 9. For thus says the Lord, sing aloud with gladness for Jacob, and raise shouts for the chief of the nations. Proclaim, give praise, and say, O Lord, save your people, the remnant of Israel. Behold, I will bring them from the north country, and gather them from the farthest parts of the earth. Among them the blind and the lame, the pregnant woman, and she who is in labor. Together, a great company, they shall return here. With weeping they shall come, and with pleas for mercy I will lead them back. I will make them walk by brooks of water, in a straight path, in which they shall not stumble. For I am a father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. This is the word of the Lord. And the New Testament reading comes from the book of Hebrews. This passage is essentially a gospel message and appropriate for communion this morning, because it is with reference to our high priest Jesus and what he has accomplished for us. Chapter 7, beginning in verse 23. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, set apart from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. This is the word of the Lord.
We stand for the Alleluia verse. Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. They came to Jericho, and as Jesus was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up, he is calling you. And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? And the blind man said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sing our next hymn. You may be seated.
Reconciling word, nor learn to trust a Savior's name. To all the world, to every place, neighbors and friends and far off lands, preach the good news of saving grace. Go while the great commission stands. Whom shall I send who hears the call? Constant in prayer through toil and pain, telling of one who died for all, to bring a lost world home again. Lord, here am I, your fire impart to this poor, cold, self-centered soul. Touch but my lips, my hand, my heart, and make a world for Christ my goal. Spirit of love within us move, Spirit of truth in power come down. So shall they hear and find reproof and their joy, their crown.
And we'll get started on the sermon as soon as I go get it out of my office. Intermission. be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is the Holy Gospel appointed for today from Mark chapter 10, especially these words. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. This is the text. There are many people and beings in the Bible who gave us different parts of the liturgy that we use every Sunday. For example, the angels who announced to the shepherds that Jesus had been born in Bethlehem. They're the ones who gave us the Gloria in Excelsis that we just sang earlier in our service. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill to men. Then there are the angels in Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah sees a vision, and the angels, the seraphim, are singing, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are full of his glory. The very words we'll be singing in a few minutes as we conduct the communion service. John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ, gave us the Agnus Dei that we will also sing in our communion liturgy. O Christ, thou Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Agnus Dei means simply Lamb of God. A man by the name of Simeon gave us the words of the Nunc Dimittis that we will sing after the communion distribution. Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people. King David in Psalm 51 gives us the words of the offertory that we will also sing today. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. So today, the person that we meet in our text for today, a man by the name of Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, has given us part of our liturgy, namely what we call the Kyrie, which is just a Latin word for Lord. Because when he heard that Jesus was coming by, as he sat there along the roadside in the city of Jerusalem, he cried out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And that's what we say in the Kyrie, Lord, have mercy upon us. Bartimaeus, as we are told, he was blind, but he could hear and he could speak. Someone, somewhere, had told Bartimaeus about Jesus, and he had heard that good news with his ears and come to faith. Without ever seeing Jesus, he came to faith in him as the Messiah, his Savior, the Son of David. And so when he heard that Jesus was coming, he used his voice to cry out, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. The people who could see, who were in the crowd, told Bartimaeus to quiet down. Jesus did not want to be bothered by some blind beggar, but Bartimaeus ignored them. He cried out all the more, Lord, have mercy on me. And that is why in the liturgy, we don't sing the Kyrie just once. We don't say Lord, have mercy just once and then move on. We keep saying it over and over again, usually at least three times in the Kyrie. We repeat, Lord, have mercy upon us. Because that's what Bartimaeus did. He kept repeating it, even though people told him to be quiet. He continued to cry out, using his voice to cry out the Kyrie. Lord, have mercy on me. And so he is the one who has contributed that to our liturgy. And as we sing that Kyrie and repeat that phrase over and over again, we're just like Bartimaeus. No one's going to stop us from crying out to the Lord, have mercy upon us. So finally, Jesus stops and he says, call him. It's just like the time when people thought that Jesus could not be bothered by little children. We read about that just a few weeks ago in the same chapter of Mark, chapter 10. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said, let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. I tell you the truth, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child shall not enter it. And he took them in his arms and blessed them, laying his hands on them. So when Jesus stopped and said, "Call him," it's probably the very same people who had said to Bartimaeus earlier, "Be quiet, don't bother Jesus." Probably those very same people, now that Jesus had said it was okay, were the ones who then went over to Bartimaeus and said, "Come on, Jesus is calling you," and brought him, led him, because he couldn't see, led him to Jesus. So when Bartimaeus got to him, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" You would think the answer is obvious. If you have a blind man, a beggar, standing there right in front of you, it would seem like Jesus would know what to do. But instead, he says, "What do you want me to do for you?" And this reminds us of our prayers. Because God already knows and it's already obvious to God what we need, but he still wants us to ask. And so that's what he did with Bartimaeus. He still wanted Bartimaeus to say the words, to say the prayer, "Lord, I want you to restore my sight." And so when we pray, God already knows what we need, but he still wants us to bring our requests to him in our prayers so that then he can answer those prayers and bless us. And when it comes to our prayers, he wants us to ask for things pertaining to our body, as Bartimaeus did, but he also wants us to ask for spiritual blessings as well. For indeed, many of the petitions of the Lord's Prayer are asking for spiritual blessings. 6 out of 7, the only one in the Lord's Prayer that asks for material things is, "Give us this day our daily bread." And so God loves it when we ask for spiritual blessings. "Lord, have mercy upon me," that simple prayer of the Kyrie. "Lord, forgive my sins." "Lord, help me be more like you, more loving and kind to others. And let me reflect you to others, and let me follow you in everything that I do." So then Jesus honors Bartimaeus' requests and grants him his sight. But then, just to remind Bartimaeus of those spiritual blessings, Jesus tells him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." Faith in Jesus is possible even if you are blind. Even though Bartimaeus could not see Jesus physically initially, he could see spiritually that Jesus was his Savior. And imagine then when his eyes were opened and he could see the one who not only saved him, but also gave him his sight. Sometimes it's even better to have physical ailments and problems to purify our faith and make it stronger. When everything is going well and we have no problems, we tend to falter in our faith and need to be brought back to our faith. Then Bartimaeus proceeds to follow Jesus. A couple of weeks ago in our gospel reading, again from Mark chapter 10, Jesus told a rich man, "Go sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." The man went away sorrowful, and we don't know if he ever returned to Jesus, because he had great possessions. Bartimaeus didn't have that problem. The only thing he probably owned was that cloak, but he had already thrown it aside when he jumped up to run to Jesus. And so he followed Jesus because he had nothing standing in his way. So Bartimaeus is the one who has given us the Kyrie. "Lord, have mercy upon us," and we're not just going to say it once. No matter who tells us to be quiet, we're going to keep repeating, "Lord, have mercy upon us." And as we look at this story so often, as we do with many stories of the Bible, we ask ourselves, how do we fit in to that story? Where would we fit into the story of Bartimaeus? It goes without saying that, but we should say it anyway, you're not Jesus. You're not the Lord. There's only one Lord, Jesus. As our epistle reading for today from Hebrews 7 points out so very clearly, there's only one high priest, one eternal high priest. All those other high priests, they died, never to be heard from again. Jesus died, yes, he did, but he came back to life and lives forever, and he's the only one. So we're not Jesus in this story. It just needs to be pointed out. Maybe perhaps you're the one who told others about Jesus so that they can believe in Jesus, about like Bartimaeus did. Someone had to tell him somewhere about Jesus so that he could come to faith, so he could cry out those words, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And it takes a bit of explanation to explain what that means. Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of David, have mercy upon me. Someone had to explain that to Bartimaeus for him to understand it. Or perhaps you are one who has stood in the way, like the people who said to Bartimaeus, "Be quiet." Maybe, and I think we could all think of times when maybe we haven't done the best job of leading people to Jesus. Hopefully not actually got in their way and told them to be quiet and don't even ask. But we can all think of times when maybe we didn't do the best job of bringing people to Jesus. Or are we the ones who have brought blind people who could not see Jesus as their Savior to Jesus so that they could know him and believe in him? I know one thing for sure. You are one whom Jesus has called. He is calling you today to follow him. He wants you to throw away anything in your life that hinders you from following him. He has received you into his kingdom through the waters of holy baptism, calling you to be his own, forgiving you all of your sins, and claiming you as his beloved brother, a child of the same heavenly Father. As one scholar has put it, the hardest thing to throw away to follow Jesus is our self-sufficiency. We all tend to think that we can do it ourselves when it comes to salvation. We're all tempted to believe that. Jesus invites us to come to him like the blind man, like blind Bartimaeus. And he calls us to follow him today and always. And he also wants us to know that he is partially blind. He can't see any of our sins anymore, because he has died for them on the cross and paid for them all completely. When it comes to our sins, he's blind. He can't see a single one because they've all been paid for when he shed his blood for us on that precious cross to pay for all of our sins. I also know that he wants you to bring others to him. This is the time of year when we especially focus on the harvest of souls that is going on in this world, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, the harvest of souls is going on. While the crops are being harvested, we are harvesting souls. But that goes on year round. God gave you the gift of sight and of hearing, and he gave you a voice so that you could use it to see and help the needs of other people. With the gift of sight, Bartimaeus was also given freedom. He no longer had to sit by the roadside and beg. But instead of using this freedom then to go his own way and do whatever he pleased, he chose to follow Jesus, now that he could do so with perfect eyesight. So every time we sing the Kyrie in our liturgy, we're joining with quite the person, a man by the name of Bartimaeus, who simply would not be silenced as he cried out there on the roadside for God's mercy. Let there be no doubt that just as God called Bartimaeus to him to heal him, Jesus has called you to himself. He is blind to your sins, can't see them at all. And he gives you sight then to see others who need to hear about Jesus. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. As noted in the bulletin, if you have not already done so, we invite you to place your offering in the offering plates on the table in the narthex. We now join in singing the words of King David in the offertory as printed.
Clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Amen.
And we receive the offerings that have already been given. Our special prayers today will include something we probably should have been praying about all summer long, our construction project going on out in front of the church. I've been assured they're really trying to get things done before winter hits, and so we'll pray that they do. I invite you to stand. Almighty and most merciful God, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we give thanks for your goodness and tender mercy, for the gift of your dear Son, Jesus. And we humbly implore you to rule and govern your church throughout the world. Bless all those who proclaim your truth, that we may be preserved in the pure doctrine of your word, and that faith in you may be strengthened, love toward others increased, and your kingdom extended. Lord, in your mercy, send forth laborers into your harvest, and sustain those who have sent that whom you have sent, that the word of reconciliation may be proclaimed to all people, and the gospel preached in all the world. Lord, in your mercy, grant health and prosperity to those in authority over us, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of Minnesota, and all those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Grant them grace to rule according to your good pleasure, for the maintenance of righteousness and the hindrance and punishment of evil. Lord, in your mercy, comfort, O God, with your Holy Spirit all those who are in trouble, want, sickness, anguish of labor, peril of death, or any other adversity. Grant courage and steadfastness, especially to those who suffer for your name's sake, that they may receive and accept their afflictions in the confidence that you will claim them as your own. Lord, in your mercy, defend us from all harm and danger to body and soul. Preserve us from false doctrine, from war and bloodshed, from epidemics and pestilence, and from all other calamities. Lord, in your mercy, cause the needed fruits of the earth to prosper, that we may enjoy them in due season. Give success to the Christian training of the young and to all lawful occupations on land, sea, and air. Lord, in your mercy, receive, O God, our bodies and souls, our talents and powers, together with the offerings we bring before you today. For by his precious blood, your Son Jesus has purchased us to be his own, that we may live under him in his kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, today we ask that you would take under your special protection and blessing those whose work is difficult and dangerous, and be with all those who put their hands to any useful work. We especially ask your blessing upon all the workers who are working to fix the road out in front of our church. We pray that you would protect them and bless their efforts so that they can complete their task on time. and give them the just rewards for their labor. Lord, in your mercy, all these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The service of the sacrament.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who, having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. eat the fish of true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who knows the death of his Lord.
I invite you to stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. We join in the Nunc Dimittis.
Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people. A light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.